But here it is. We're going.
What's the difference between being live and just a video? Okay, this is now anyone can see this?
Now there's like a YouTube channel that literally no one's going to see.
This is so awesome. Yeah. Hold on, I'll periscope it.
Okay, but I'm going to take a Vine.
Okay.
Let's see. Yeah. So I'm teaching like a WordPress class. It'll be kind of cool.
Alright, here we go. Hope I don't have any, like, you know, personal information showing.
Which, should I have a notification? Somebody I'm following started a Periscope live stream. A Google Hangout via live stream. Or a Google Hangout. Oh,
so there's actually people watching this.
How deep does it go?
This is excellent.
It's too weird. All right, someone Snapchat it. It's weird. There's a lot of delay. It's too funny. One sec. All right, I'm gonna Snapchat real time back to you. This is what I assume people do.
People are already buzzing about what hangstream is. By that I mean that one person. It's pretty much a new app that is in development, and yeah, you're probably do you have any startup cash?
Yeah, how's that?
Well, start? I think that we're about to Snapchat this to really like open the gates, so. We'll see. Stay tuned.
Well, here's the thing. I think to Snapchat it, you have to...
You have to leave the app.
Fuck. Hey, you I have an iPad. I have an iPad. Let me get Periscope on... let me get Snapchat on the iPad. And then
you're a gay boy.
All right.
We lost followers on this so quickly.
Everyone's like, yeah, not that
one
cool.
One just calling us a gay boy very quickly. Oh, there goes another one.
How many followers do we have?
Two currently.
Oh, hey.
And through this social media vortex, I think one is you. So it's
only, I'm not on Periscope right now. So.
And the other person just probably doesn't realize that this is open.
Yeah.
Yep, now it's just you.
Most followers in this so quickly. Everyone's like, yeah, not that cool. He's calling us a gay boy very quickly. Oh, there goes another one.
Alright, I'm ending this.
Okay.
I'm ending this before I get incepted.
Through this session, what is you? Yeah, I think I'm we should just involving my iPad and another iMac, so we can get down.
Stop! I'm gonna have to learn this.
What tech? No, it's just you.
Why I ever want to replay that? Well, that was successful.
Yeah. Wow. We're just like, right, we should turn that into a business somehow, though. If we could like cash in on that.
I've got like the replay of our past conversation, the closeout of our conversation going.
I don't know where it's coming from, but I can still hear me talking. It's
you do. It's the social media echo.
It's the sound of our voices reverberating through
one of all of the people,
the tubes of the internet. Tonight we have made an impact.
I can't hear anything that you're saying because all I've heard is like stuff that we said like 30 seconds ago.
Is it coming from your phone? I don't know where it's coming from. But
no.
I can still hear me talking. It's oh my god.
How do we break the internet?
I think we fundamentally broke it. Okay, I'm gonna mute.
It's our voices echoing through time.
Tonight we've made an impact. I can't hear anything that you're saying because all I've heard is like stuff that we said.
But, and all I can think is this really what I sound like?
Is it coming from your phone? No.
Hey, can you hear me now?
Yeah, but I still hear the other thing.
So I totally muted everything I have. You should look and see if you have another.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna mute. Sorry, voices echoing through time.
I'm hearing it like three times. Yeah, so I had another one of our original hangouts opened.
Okay.
So there were like two hangouts going on.
That's what I figured. There, if you
back, lane all through.
If you go back to like Google Plus, and click any of the invites, it opens up a second one instead of like knowing that this one is already associated. It's a terrible way of explaining it, but like,
no.
Yeah. It's so I ended up one or two times I realized it, but I ended up with like quite a few hangouts open.
Yeah, it is. I thought I'd close them all, but obviously not the case.
It's all good. It happens. Just be better next time.
I'll try. This is how I learn. I had to go to a it was supposed to be like a Shark Tank thing yesterday that our company was involved with.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we like ended up randomly sponsoring this thing. I don't even know how. But it was supposed to be like Shark Tank, but it was for sports-based companies only. So it was called Sports Tank. And it was a lot of entrepreneurial people. Are you taking a piss? Oh no, you're changing laundry. I thought that was a shower curtain, sorry. But but yeah, some guy was like, "Oh, you know, we haven't made mistakes. We like just have lots of experience." So yeah, heavily experienced. Huh?
You've taken that to heart. That's like your
thing. That's my new thing. Basically, just try to do the spin everything to be a positive.
I've just learned a lot recently.
Huh?
It's like I don't make mistakes. I've just like learned quite a lot recently.
Yeah, exactly.
Keep a positive vibe on it.
Yeah. What's Lindsay up to tonight?
Lindsay is working at she has two jobs. She works at she's actually kind of bartending at a Mexican restaurant up the street.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, she's it's her first night bartending. I think it's more like she has a private party and there's like a private little bar thing, so she's just kind of making mixed drinks for like 10 people.
Oh, that's cool.
But yeah, she's she does that and then she works for sorry, this is super obnoxious, but I have to get done because I'm going to be gone all day tomorrow. She works at, like, a green construction place. It does, like, green remodels for houses.
Oh, yeah, I remember you mentioning that.
Yeah, she's enjoying it a lot. She's like kind of their marketing person, I guess. Like, she's doing the Twitters and the Facebooks.
That's cool.
Yeah. All right. I figure out how to start all this and get out of here before it gets super loud for you. Okay. I don't know. Mission accomplished.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you listened to any sweet podcasts lately?
I listened to the new Yeah Dude. I took the train from Charlotte to Greensboro today because I had to go out for work.
I was laughing to myself on the bus like a fucking madman.
Yeah, I was too. I wasn't paying attention for some of the beginning, but there were a couple parts where I was like really trying to hide that it, you know, I was sitting there laughing to myself on this basically Amtrak that was pretty much exclusively black people.
Yeah, that's kind of how the public buses are here, so.
Yeah, so it was the one part where they were talking about smoking placenta. And what was the other? They went to like some really gross humor.
I feel like I have to look up the show notes because I can't really remember what.
Yeah, the childbirth. They were like talking about childbirth or something. And I was like, I'm about to pass forward through this if they don't change the subject.
Nothing like I. That's how I felt about him talking about taking like doing his dental surgery.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I thought I was going to die.
That was good. That didn't get me as much as like the childbirth thing. And then I was laughing so hard. We were talking about the pigs getting the virus.
That was such a good yeah. Everything fucking about it.
Center. Let 1,000 pigs loose. Just let.
Oh no! I'm looking at the show notes now. His entire they have it. They have it in the show notes as whipping a bitch on Beyonce. Like it was.
I felt kind of dumb because I missed some of the Beyonce story of just how he tried to like roll around, I guess, and or like tried to turn his car around and get to Beyonce.
He was telling a story like he was driving down, you know, Santa Clara Boulevard or whatever famous fucking street he, like, lives on, and he saw a black SUV, and he saw a woman in a flower shop that had this, like, black floppy hat, and he was like, that's Bae's hat. Like, I know it. She's been rocking that for the last couple of months, and he did, like, a U-turn on a red light and, like, turned around and, like, rolled up right behind the, like, the Escalade or whatever, and, like, got out, and, like, the security guard, like, started, like, walking briskly towards him or do whatever, and he's just kind of like, I don't even, like, and the entire thing is Jonathan just telling him that, like, that's not cool, like, he could have been shot.
Yeah. I kind of pieced it together later in the story, but I missed his first time, or later in the show, but I kind of, like, missed his telling of the story.
Yeah, just like, oh, Jonathan, it was beautiful. She was in a flower shop, the sun was glistening, and she just smiled at me, and I smiled right back, and in that moment, I was good. Like,
I thought it was funny when he was talking about becoming a bus driver in a small town in Tennessee. He was like, there's Mr. Ramatelli with his thermos. How'd you get here? We used to hobnob with Beyonce in LA.
I love when stories come back around later on in the show, like when they were talking, like the Dallas Cowboys episode. Like, yeah. I loved how that one spanned like two or three episodes.
Yeah. That
was good. Some of you have expressed concern about my bird watching.
Seth, I think, especially is really good at that of like continuing to bring it up like throughout the course of the show.
Yeah.
I can't think of a good example right off the top of my head, but the, I don't know, just all that stuff.
Shakabra. he's got a little bit more of like the stand up vibe.
Like yeah.
He's like a professional.
Yeah. But doing, I guess with being an actor and stuff like that, Maybe it's a little bit more the entertainment side.
Yeah, he's an entertainer. I'm really excited. I'm really excited to watch this Celebrity Name Game episode.
Are they gonna air it, or like are they his guy's gonna be on it for sure?
No, I don't think anything's for sure yet. But they're like, that's just kind of, like I don't think I know anything more than the average listener does. But it just sounds like they're working on it.
Yeah. I thought that was. I have to admire his dedication to like getting two guys and being like, okay, this is how we're gonna do it. Like.
I like
it's
to
like, yeah, that one put strategy in the Celebrity Name Game.
Yeah. I like to believe there's like a hazing process going on in some barn out in LA, like out in the outskirts where he's just got
have to be at work. No, Celebrity Name Game.
Yeah. This is your job now.
Yeah, exactly. This is your job now. 2 hours later.
Oh, nice.
About to be dark. I'm gonna try this coffee beverage now.
Oh, be careful! I think there's caffeine in there.
Well, that's kind of why I was holding off on it to be honest.
Yeah.
So if you're warning of that, I actually may hold off because I'm gonna get up early, ish. Not so early. But I was worried about sleeping after having it.
It tastes like some pretty decent cold brew coffee.
Yeah,
it's good. There's some awesome cold brew coffee here that they sell. That we're kind of obsessed with called Sometimes. So good.
Nice. So, have you ever heard of the band Swans?
I don't think so.
Well, they're this like really heavy metal band. Like, I went to go see him at Bonnaroo. This is, like, a time killer. Like, we had a little bit of time, and I was like, well, you know, I got nothing to do. I'll go see this band, Swans. And they were so loud at, like, an outdoor venue that, like, I didn't even make it to the first song because it was so loud. But Pat and Drew went to go see him at Cat's Cradle over in Raleigh tonight, and they were just like, expecting to just like get demolished because I guess like the band like turns the air conditioning off and stuff like that to like really just make it a huge miserable experience, and it's a bunch of 60-year-old guys just playing like the heaviest metal that they can imagine.
And, it like, sounds like the most
trying to piss people off. Heard.
yeah. Like when I saw it, like I said, I was at Bonnaroo's and I like walked up. I was like, oh, I'll check this out. And the band hadn't started. I looked over and there was some girl in with like a black lace umbrella and like, you know, wearing like pilgrim shoes. I don't even know what you'd call them other than like black leather shoes or like this like slight heel, like this like dress, which is not really like, you know, standard, and like a black dress, which you're out in the sun, you know, it's not pretty, not standard festival attire. And I was like, huh, this is, what an interesting person to be at this show. I wonder what kind of music this band makes. And then the guy came out and just played like an electric violin, like just like back and forth for like 5 minutes. It was like, I'm out of here. I'm gonna go. I was like, I'm gonna go lay on the ground and listen to Feist somewhere. Like, <that's> not me.
How did I end up in this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they like went there basically just to get like brutalized by it.
Yeah. When you go to a festival, like. Yeah, there's all those time killer bands, and you have to kind of be like a, you have to be a student of the music.
Yeah.
You gotta kind of, experiment. But you also have to know when just to get the fuck out.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the nice thing about with Bonnaroo, you guys went to Firefly, was it?
Yeah, that was up in Delaware.
Yeah, no, it, like, Bonnaroo gets, like, so big so that some people, it's, like, a 30-minute walk or, like, you know, you take a golf cart in.
Yeah.
You would do, like, 10 only, so it was perfect. So if you had, like, an hour or something like that, you could pop out, you know, in the middle of the day and, like, go back to the tent and eat, because 10 only is, like, really close. It's the closest you can be without, you know, you don't have a car or any of that stuff.
At Bonnaroo, it's that close?
Huh?
At Bonnaroo, it's that close?
Yeah. But, I mean, you can... Some people park with their cars or an RV or a VIP pass. You can get that close. But that's, like, the closest like free for all spot. So we would, and it was nice because, like I said, in the middle of the day, you could like run out and like go eat food or like drink a beer or something like that, like in between bands that you wanted to see. So, sometimes it doesn't always work out that way timing wise. So you end up filling up stuff or catching part of shows and stuff.
Firefly, I don't remember how long of a walk it is, but it was over a mile to like back to camp. Like it was a pretty big commitment. In Delaware. It was like one of those things where like we only went back to camp. Like we might go back once and then, but like once we were out, we were out.
That's the way it is. Like that's the way it can be for most people at Bonner. I mean, I think every year we parked there. If we would have camped with our car, with the exception of maybe like 1 year, that's the same way it would have been because it was like a 30-minute walk on Sunday to go get our car, and we were like basically right outside the gates. So, like I said, I definitely, definitely appreciated being close because otherwise, like I said, if you're with your car, you've got a kind of different experience to have like a 30-minute walk in. And even with, like, the headliner bands and stuff like that, like Red Hot Chili Peppers, like, we didn't necessarily want to see them, but we could still hear them, like, the same as if we just couldn't see them. But you could still hear them live, like, which at a festival of, like, that size, unless you're, like, really up front, or in the pit or something like that, you're not really, you're probably watching on TV screen anyways, so.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how we saw Red Hot. We were way in the back. But we were right up front for Foster the People and for Vampire Weekend, and those were two of my favorite shows.
That's cool.
Yeah. Vampire Weekend kicked ass. I loved it.
Really?
Yeah. I'm a Vampire Weekend fan now.
I guess I wouldn't know what to expect out of them for a live show. I like their music. But
they're weird, and it's not really justified until you see them in person. They're, like, so energetic and stuff, and it makes sense all of a sudden. It's like,
yeah,
the way you're jumping around, like, that is the type of sounds you're going to get out of a guitar, like.
Yeah.
I don't know. But
I would have never thought of them being, like, a jump-around band.
Yeah, they're so weird. I'm not really sure what it is.
Yeah. That's fun. Yeah, I think the only time like for on the main stage that I was ever close or like kind of camped out for anything, and basically with that just meant waiting in line was for Tenacious D, and that was that was pretty cool. But because Conan O'Brien, that was like the summer that Conan O'Brien was like in between jobs, so
he came
out to like announce them, and they came out and played all their stuff. But that was like middle of the day. When Pat went to go see Pearl Jam, he had to wait for, like, 8 hours. Like, as soon as they opened up the gates, like, sprint to try to get in line to, like, beat out all these people. And then, like, he was, one or two rows back, but he had to, like, sit against a wall all day and basically spend one whole day just waiting in line to be, like, front row for Pearl Jam. So, I guess. Festivals.
Yeah. Big G, though.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah. Red Rocks was really weird. I love it because of it, like, has a lot of significance as far as music history and stuff, but Gigantic was pretty interesting to see there. It was, I don't know, we saw, it was so many, like, Denver high school or whatever kids on acid.
We were there. We were just like, oh my god. We were like too old to be here. Like everyone here, kids are looking like of age. They're kind of like too old. Yeah, because they were like it seemed like roaming groups of like 15-year-olds of like just like wearing neon and looking fucking messed up.
Yeah. So. Dabs, Mollies. Yeah.
Dude, we took the party bus out there, and the guy on the party bus, who was supposed to be, like, the, like, lead guy, was, like, talking. He's like, all right, the only rule is don't put anything out the window, but other than that, like, do whatever you want. If you want to, like, do coke off some girl's tits, like, next to you, like, that's fine. And then he was like, He's like, hey, like, Doug in the back, he's like, you got that dose for me, man? Like, he, like, got it, and we're like, this is the guy who was just, like, checking us in, like, supposed to be, like, the lead, like, you know, the group leader of this thing. And then the guy who was our driver looked like some cliche hipster. He had on, like, a bolo tie, like, you know, with his shirt, like, buttoned all the way up and, like, aviator glasses, you know, with, like, prescription lenses in them. And he was just, like, driving along, like, to this, like, trance music, just, like, yeah, like, getting really into it. Like, fuck. He's got to be high as shit, but it was an experience.
Yeah, yeah. We went back to Red Rocks quite a few times. Like, I guess we got there really early. We got there around like 2, and the show was at 8 or 9.
Mm-hmm.
So we got there super early and just kind of like walked around and we ate. I guess Red Rocks is. What town is that? That's not Golden, is it?
I was gonna say it's closest to Golden.
Okay.
I don't know if there's like a city of Red Rocks or something, but it's
10 or 20 minutes away.
Yeah, like Golden's like part of like the foothills sort of thing. Yeah. So I think it may be closest to Golden. I don't know.
Yeah. So we like ate at Golden and had like mimosas or whatever, drove up to Red Rocks, kind of did a little touristy, like took our pictures and did all that stuff.
Yeah.
Came down, got a case of beer, went back up, and then did the show. And then we came back the next day, actually.
Yeah.
Which was pretty fun.
That was cool.
Yeah. And we kind of did more. It was so pretty out there the day we were there. I have a picture of it. It's over our fireplace right now. I'm looking at it. And it was like such an unreal day.
Yeah.
But
that's cool, man.
Yeah.
I've never actually spent time at the park out there past, you know, really it's all been at the amphitheater, so.
Yeah.
But I've heard from people who've like lived in Denver and stuff like that. They're like, it's awesome how you can just like make like an entire day out of going to something like that. You know, you go hike or something like that and then see the show or
yeah.
You know, so
there are quite a few people like running.
Yeah.
A lot of runners and bikers going up through
there. Yeah, I think the first time that we went out there we went on like a tour. Further was getting ready to play, so like we were out there like, you know, noon or something like that, but the tailgate was already like, you know, all packed out of people just like getting ready to go watch Further, and at the time we're like, I don't want to go see some huge like hippie, you know, jam band kind of thing, but
Further
actually would have been Dead? Huh?
Is Further Grateful Dead?
Yeah, it's like great. It's like some collection of the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, some of the people that are still around.
Yeah, but I don't know who, because there are a couple like variations of the Grateful Dead, as I understand it, that are not the Grateful Dead. This right. Summer, the plan is the Grateful Dead.
Oh, really?
4th of July in Chicago, man. Apparently, the tickets are already going for like thousands of dollars. Like they sold out, and like the secondary market is like, forget about it.
I heard about that either on Oh Yeah Dude or Roderick on the Line is my other podcast that I go to.
I think it was Oh Yeah Dude because I've heard that. What's Roderick on the Line? Is that a tennis? No, it's an Australian guy or something?
No, there's a guy, Merlin Mann is kind of, I think he has a couple of different podcasters. He's like an internet personality. Okay. And I guess like every week he Skypes this dude, John Roderick, who is like the quintessential like Seattle guy.
Okay.
He's older. He's like been in a few Seattle bands. One's called like The Long Winter, and like kind of never super famous, but like
yeah,
his shit's on Spotify. Like it's been around for quite some time. And like, he's considering running for mayor in Seattle, this mayor or like councilman or something like that.
Yeah.
But I don't know. He's just like, I think he would enjoy listening to it. He's just funny how he talks.
Because I've definitely heard about it.
Yeah, I think I've mentioned it to you quite a few times. But he's like, he spent some. He grew up in Alaska and moved down to Seattle, like in his teens or whatever, and he's like hiked around Europe and like has all these like weird kind of things that he does, and he goes off on tangents talking about stupid shit, and it's just like pretty interesting to talk to. And the other guy's just kind of like, he adds a lot to the conversation, but he's a little bit more of like the let's keep it going kind of.
Yeah. Things. Yeah. That's crazy. Crazy how that happens.
Yeah,
it's starting podcasts.
It's a little bit of an art form.
Huh?
It's a little bit of an art form.
Oh no, it definitely is. Like to, I mean, if yeah, dude's been doing it for what, like 9 years or something like that, and they
yeah,
they have to have been. No, because I guess they can put out two episodes. Anyways, but yeah, they've you know, there's definitely an art form to it. You can make it a full time, you know, business if you're just trying to start from scratch. In terms of getting it launched and this, that, and the other, but having I can see how having some experience in radio or something like that would help out.
Yeah. Have you heard of it's this podcast called Startup?
Mm-mm.
It's a podcast about starting a business, and the business happens to be a podcast network. So like, try to think about that.
So it's like the live like followings of this podcast, which is also a business.
Yeah. So every week they talk about like how they're starting their business, like getting funding and stuff, and like this guy's business is to start a podcast network. Like he wants to have like 4 or 5 podcasts and, you know, get a cut of the ad money and like help produce it, like high quality serial style, like,
yeah,
you know, like production. So he wants to have this podcast network, and their very first podcast is about starting the podcast network.
So it's their podcast, and then they're trying to say, hey, come join our network.
Yeah, so it's like episode 3, hiring, like, you know, we got our first, you know, employee today, and you know, blah, 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 here's how it worked out, like, you know, here's some of the challenges you might face, like, when you're hiring your first employee, blah, blah, blah. Kind of interesting.
That has to be an extremely awkward episode for that first employee to hear.
Yeah.
Like, we kind of didn't like Doug that much, but we settled on him, like, because we thought he had some good skill set. Like, oh, fuck. Oh, my God.
There's one of my coworkers, like, in conversation, it's only been like 2 times, but I let him know the second time it happened. He was like, yeah, man, well, you almost didn't get hired because, like, blah, 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 and he would say something. Like, in the middle of a conversation, it's like, what the fuck is that supposed to be?
Yeah,
like,
what the fuck is that?
He said it the second time, and I was like, hey, man, just a little side note there, like, that's a little fucking demeaning.
We do work together at the same job now.
Yeah, like, oh, is our job title the same? I don't know. That's weird. Like,
that's ridiculous. Well, when I worked for this crazy guy out of college, he used to, towards the end, he started telling me, like, oh, that guy? You mean the guy who didn't want to hire you? like, tell me that. I'd be like, well, what do you want me to say, Top? Like, you know.
Yeah, that's how it was. Like, this guy would be like, yeah, well, you, yeah, this one guy didn't want you to be on the team because, like, you did whatever during the process. But, like, you know, we fought for you, whatever. It's like, oh, come the fuck on. Like,
yeah, that's ridiculous. This is trying to, like, make some, like
slang. Yeah, what do you need me to do? Like, how can I make it up to you?
Yeah, like you owe me.
Yeah, your sacrifice has been appreciated, man.
That's crazy, man.
Yeah.
So how many people do you, like, typically have to, like, work with or, like, is your team or your group or whatever?
We've got 3 people, including me, that do, like, what I do. So that's, like, front-end development. And then there's, like, 6 or 7 back-end engineers. I don't deal with them on a daily basis. I'll usually deal with, like, one or two, depending on projects. And then, man, we've got... There's two or three project managers I talk to on a daily basis that are, like, giving me things, you know, setting up meetings and, like, doing requirements and things like that. And then I talk to, like, people in design every once in a while. We're trying to talk more. But,
So there's, like, this might be a dumb question. There's, like, graphic designers of, like, hey, can you, like, chop up this artwork so we can place it into a, on a page or something? Is it, like, back-end design kind of thing?
If it's not necessarily, like, chopping up designs. It's more of, you know, what should this button look like?
Yeah.
How do we want, like, when we get, like, a little box that pops up with a video in it, like, what's the shadow going to look like?
Yeah.
So kind of, like, individual, we think of everything as, like, a component, like a little piece. And you design each of the little pieces, and then we let our, like, people that build the actual pages, they can grab out, like, we're making a bunch of Legos, and they can build whatever house they want.
Okay.
That's kind of how we do it. Serving, like, across the site's, like, super consistent. That's the idea. Yeah. Not
always reality.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how we work, you know? That's how we run AWS.
What's that stand for? Amazon World Systems or something?
Amazon Web Services.
Web Service. That would make more sense. I'm sure eventually as the drones and robots start to take over, it'll just be World Services. But
yes, that's obviously the next step.
In this stone age that we're living in currently.
Yeah. Apparently, I heard this from somebody, not even like an Amazon person. The last person I would hear Amazon-related news from is another Amazon person, because no one actually knows anything important. Like, I hear about all the cool shit from Reddit just like everybody else.
Yeah.
How we are.
Yeah.
But, yeah, apparently, like, they just got approval from the FAA for some sort of, for their drones for delivering packages. But it's already, like, obsolete compared to the stuff they're designing and they're working on. Like, it's so far out of band, like, FAA can't keep up with it.
That's insane.
Yeah.
I heard someone say something that they were talking about, like, the future of online shopping could be, like, everyone has a 3D printer and you just, like, 3D print all of your stuff. Like, you essentially just pay for the blueprint or the format or, you know, the program. And then it'll just, you know, for some goods, I mean, hard to 3D print, like, toilet paper, but, you know, you can just, you know, buy a tchotchke.
A year or two ago, I definitely didn't have the know-how to do it right, but it probably wouldn't have mattered. It's probably too late now, but I was thinking about that. I was like, what would a website look like where instead of buying, like, WordPress themes or whatever, like, instead of buying those files, you're buying, you know, like, it's kind of like the iTunes or whatever of 3D printables. Like, oh, I need, you know, whatever part for my car. Like, I'll go here.
Yeah.
Whatever, and buy it off that. But it's a huge undertaking. I assume there's something like that out there already, but...
That would actually be a really good idea if you could figure out a way to, like, just have it so that all these independent 3D print shops can, like, host, you know, or bid on jobs or something like that. That would be really, I mean, like you said, there may be something for it out there already, but if you can be like, hey, like,
you know,
3D plans or something where someone says, oh, I need something 3D printed, because even in Greensboro, I mean, not the best example, but there's, like, one 3D print guy that we know of, or that I know of, and there may be more, but it's one guy who just invests in this, like, huge machine, or, you know, invests in this machine that he has a huge amount of cash, you know, tied into, and he's got to find people that need things 3D printed, which isn't necessarily super readily available, but if you put it, you kind of make, like, one-stop shop for it where people could either, like, get plans for 3D printing from people who can do CAD drawings and then, like, have the people, like, hook them up to print them, which I don't know how you would handle that, because then you're basically saying, like, hey, all you guys can come to our website and then just, like, cut out the website because you can just go around directly to them. But then to have it so that someone could be like, hey, I need someone who can do, make a 3D, you know, gorilla toy for me, and I need someone to print it. So, like, that would be, I wonder if something like that exists. Because then you can have all that stuff, and as it gets cheaper and cheaper and becomes more and more popular, then you could potentially have people just, you know, are making their little, their CAD drawing, and then, you know, if you have a printer and you're like, oh, I like that, you know, toy or whatever, they run that off the printer, you know.
Yeah. So I was thinking of it on that level of, like, you know, if you want to make a WordPress site, if you need it for your small business, you can go and you can spend a ton of money for custom stuff, or you can spend $20 and, like, download a template.
Yeah.
And there are websites where you can make these templates and you can go sell them. It's like a marketplace for that, right? Okay. So you're just selling, like, a $20 template and you get $15 out of it or whatever the number is that, you know, they cut out at a lot. So I was thinking like that, but I really like the idea of kind of, like, putting these mass, like, connecting the printers, people who have made that investment with, you know, whatever sort of demand there is. Like, that's kind of cool. Like, I'm sure people like that are, they're kind of losing money every minute that machine's not running.
Yeah, and it's not something that everybody necessarily has a super, I mean, I think the guy that we knew in Greensboro, he charged a lot for it. It was like, you know, $30 an hour or something, and some of these things, even just to make like a little box, took like 4 hours. So it's like you can make a lot of money off of it as it is. Well, you're not making a lot of money off of it because you've got this, you know, huge expensive machine here, material. Excuse me. And this, that, and the other. But you can, I don't know. People, it's like an emerging technology, but I don't know how well connected everyone is in it, and, you know, how much access the regular person has to it.
Well, how much of that's because there isn't a service like that.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah.
That's interesting. Let's think on that one. Yeah. Let's see if it's still a good idea later.
Huh? Yeah, exactly. Man, I've had so many good ideas at the time, but then, you know, think about it, and it's like, nah.
Well, luckily this is all going to be saved to a YouTube page, so someone can...
Someone could be out there watching it right now and being like, oh, shit, like, Zuckerberging it.
Yeah.
If that's a word.
We really teed it up for them, though.
Yeah. We've got a good deal of lawyer fees for the whoever's watching.
Yeah. Hey, man, the twins, they got a little bit of money.
Yeah, they did. They did. It seemed like, I mean, whatever, my knowledge of the Facebook thing is basically, what is it, the social network, but it seemed like he screwed over a lot of people.
Yeah. Whose knowledge of Facebook isn't the social network?
Yeah, exactly, but, you know, who's the guy with, you know, $1 billion at 30 years old? Mark Zuckerberg. So, I guess if you have a couple people who don't like you versus a $1 billion at 30 and never having to work again. It's a cost-benefit analysis, I guess.
Apparently, Tom from MySpace is like an Instagram photographer now.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he. That's just what he does, which is really cool. He just like travels to like Norway and shit and takes pictures of, like, the Northern Lights.
And then post it on Instagram?
Yeah, yeah, he just, like,
But not, like, for Instagram, just independently. He's just like, oh, I'm an Instagram photographer.
Yeah, that's just what he does.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I made a social media platform, but now I'm just, you know, big on another one.
Well, I saw something. It was, like, a screenshot. I like to think it's real. It was on Twitter or whatever. Someone was like, you know, Mark Zuckerberg's real. Fuck Tom from MySpace. Like, you know, MySpace is nothing now. And yeah. Tom from MySpace replied to it. It was like, I'm paraphrasing, but the gist of it was like, dude, I sold a company when I was like 28 years old for $450 million. Like, you're probably hoping that your boss lets you leave work half an hour early today. Like, fuck you. And it was just like,
that's pretty funny.
Like, 100% true.
Yeah, no, seriously. What's, like, what is it, Snapchat guy, like, turning down, like, all that money at, like, 22 years old?
Yeah, he turned down $300 million, and they're thinking it's $3 billion now, but...
Man, if I was him, I would just get out. Obviously, it's easier said than done, but...
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of social media... or at least the trend, I guess, with a couple exceptions, has been that it kind of runs its course, like any product life cycle. And
yeah,
I don't know. Facebook's changing, but I don't think Facebook will go away. But it's, I don't know. It's interesting. Yeah. I at 22 certainly would have not turned down, you know, $450 million, whatever it was.
Yeah. I mean, you gotta do, like, One Direction guy. Like, you just walk away at some point. Like, I'm happy. Like, that's... I think I'll be good with $400 million.
Yeah.
Like...
And should I take four?
I can probably make that last.
Yeah. What's crazy, man, is one of my parents' friends... got divorced. The guy, like, sold some company and made, like, a whole shitload of money. And I guess after he made a whole shitload of money, proceeded to cheat on his wife. And, you know, they didn't have a prenup or anything like that. So they go to split up. And, you know, half of that huge sale of his company is hers. And she ended up getting, like, half of it. It was, like, couple hundred million dollars, I think, or maybe it was a couple hundred million, but let's say $50 million or something like that, because the guy had some huge accounting firm, or I don't know what it was, but I was like, what the hell would you do with, like, that amount of money? I started, like, running through, like, I think it was like, if I just had $50 million, like buy some insane house and some insane car and still have, like, money to spend and be like, what do you do? Yeah, like, what, even after I did the, like, oh, I bought all the fun things I ever wanted, be like, well, that really wasn't necessarily that much.
Yeah.
I guess people then try to go and start other things to make more money from their money.
Yeah. Yeah. At that point, you just buy a newspaper or something.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Start buying other things to generate revenue for you.
Oh, yeah. 50 million might buy you a newspaper now. I think they're declining in value.
Yeah, well, that's kind of, yeah, definitely not a newspaper. Definitely get a startup thing, very popular.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Get involved in some of that stuff.
Our Jeff B. bought New York Times or whatever. What did he buy? Yeah. Yeah, he bought something. He bought the Washington Post.
Huh?
He bought the Washington Post.
Damn, who bought that?
The Amazon CEO.
Oh, damn. That's pretty crazy.
Like, why?
They were probably like, please buy us, we need money.
Yeah.
You print money. Like,
sell us on Kindles, please.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah, Washington Post, outcome standard on Kindles.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're a Vice fan, aren't you? Vice News.
I don't watch too much of it. I did watch Noisy Atlanta.
I love that. The show needs to be taught in schools.
Yeah, it does.
I saw that they're getting a nightly news show on HBO, apparently.
Oh, really?
Yeah, which would be interesting.
Dude, I'm so bummed. This girl that worked at Pinkney Marketing back when I worked there, she gave me her HBO Go password, which, like, turned out to be her Time Warner Cable password. So I had, like, HBO, Showtime, like, AMC, everything, all. I just used her password for all that shit. After, like, three and a half years, she changed her password, and it's, I don't know what to do. Like, I lost, like, it sucks so much. But I guess HBO just launched their streaming service. Like,
did they?
I think so.
They're about to.
Okay, yeah, if they didn't, they're about to.
Yeah.
But, yeah, one of my coworkers had good things to say about Sling. Apparently that's out in, like, general.
Yeah, we got it. I watch it, like, at lunch on Candace's iPad now. Like, I think we just signed up for it. I think it was last weekend or the weekend before. So I'll, like, watch it when I'm eating lunch or whatever and just kind of trying to break up my work day. So yeah. It's, like, it's been all right. I don't know if it's Candace's iPad or the app, but I find that, like, after I close it, like, if I just, like, throw the cover over her iPad, like, I've got to restart the app to get it to work again, because if I then go to open it again, it doesn't pick right back up. It just gives me, like, a black screen. So I've got to go in and reopen it. That would be my only complaint about it, but we're either going to take a Roku from Candace's parents' house this weekend or buy one, because the only other problem is that we have an Apple TV and it's not Apple TV compatible. You can watch it on iOS,
yeah,
but you can't mirror it onto your TV and do all that stuff. So basically you're stuck watching on a computer or a phone or something. So, which is kind of a bummer.
PlayStation app. Yeah.
I was trying to read about how to do it, and people are like, yeah, you can pay like $15 a month for an app that'll basically like hack around it to make it so that you can mirror your iPad onto your TV in like some different way. But it was like, that's kind of defeating the purpose to like then pay another $20 to like get around it when, you know, I don't need it most of the time.
You can't do it through the Apple TV.
No, when you go to do it, it says, like, there's a problem, like, with connectivity. So it'll play it, but it won't AirPlay.
So you're trying to, like, mirror your, like, your window over there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I wonder if it works on the Chromecast. The Chromecast kind of sucks if you're trying to mirror, like, a Chrome tab over to something, but it
does. Because I think, like, Apple TV is the only one that's not compatible, but from everything I've read online, they're like either they're gonna come around to compatibility because it has to have, you know, Apple's like a huge segment of the market for them to just like ignore, and apparently they were kind of like in talks about it, but they're like both companies were just kind of like, all right, whatever, we've got, you know, four other devices, like we don't need you, kind of thing. Like,
it looks like we have a lot of Amazon stuff.
But Candace was telling me tonight, I've not heard about it. I guess Apple is planning on launching like their own like streaming service, like an almost like Apple Cable. So it was like that could be tied to that's happening. So I don't know, man. It'll be I don't know, I think a lot of that stuff will change. And my aunt works in sales for ESPN.
Yeah.
And she was saying that she said starting in April, and this was like a couple months back before I like knew about all these streaming service things, she was like, oh, starting in April, all of our sales stuff, because the way that it goes right now is you either buy like you know, internet advertising, you buy, you know, a streaming service advertising, you buy, you know, actual ESPN, like, cable advertising. She was like, now when you buy a package, it's all going to go on their end, you know, if they're going to sell the Jeep or Navy or whoever it is, or Nike or, you know, something like that. It used to be that you'd be like, okay, like, we want this, that, and the other. Like, now it's all going to go across as, like, one department. So I think that probably means that they're planning on shifting a lot of stuff to streaming. So companies can just say, okay, we want to buy, you know, the gold, silver, or bronze package and have, you know, this level of, you know, commercials and streaming and advertising. So it'll be...
That makes sense.
Yeah, no, it definitely does, and I've noticed in Sling, even in just the last couple weeks, or the, you know, 2 weeks that we've had it, that usually when it goes to commercial, at least on ESPN, it just starts airing ESPN commercials, but it now is, like, increasingly starting to do, like, you know, different, like, companies' commercials a little bit more like regular TV. In the place that it was. So I don't know if that's part of the ESPN rollover of it, or if that's the way that Sling selling it, of like, okay, you can have, you know, in this time spot, you know, what we're streaming on television, instead of it cutting to an ESPN ad, you know,
well, you I wonder how
a little bit of time. But I think that would have to be on ESPN side, because they're probably controlling the, you know, content streaming for that.
Well, I mean, it would make sense to me. I don't know if it's how it works, but I would hope that Sling, not hope, but my feeling about how it works is that Sling is gathering information on who you are based off your habits and stuff like that, and it is displaying ads, and ESPN, like, I mean, I guess, I don't know, so you're saying ESPN's picking the ads, not the Sling service?
That's the way that I would understand it, is that right now ESPN's saying, okay, if, you know, my understanding as to the way that it was that previously when you bought advertising on ESPN, you would say, like, okay, I want a 30-second advertisement, and I want, you know, 5 banner ads on ESPN.com, and I want, you know, one on, you know, when I'm watching ESPNU, you know, when it goes to commercial, we want our 30-second spot to play on there too. Now all of that is tied together. So instead of it being like, you know, the ESPN.com department, the ESPN TV department, you know, the ESPNU department, it's all one cohesive piece of, like, this is the package that we sell. So that, you know, the commercial that airs on ESPN.com is airing on the ESPN streaming site, you know, when they go to that break or whatever too. Because right now, if, you know, when I'm sitting here eating lunch and I'm watching, you know, the ESPN thing, when it goes to commercial, it will either say, like, you know, commercial break, like, you know, we'll be right back with the ESPN logo and just like a little, like, oh, we're coming back. But then it starts playing like the This Is SportsCenter ads. So it's like, you know, all the mascots and, you know, ESPN anchors doing dumb stuff, not really advertising anything to ESPN. But, like, we'll maybe, like, get peppered in with, like, a, you know, Sprint commercial or something like that every now and then.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that's increasingly going to change in the coming months to where it's more like regular television, where you have a bunch of 30-second spots for different companies, you know, as spots that are being held by ESPN, you know, This Is SportsCenter ads. If those are going to start getting pulled off for, you know, a Verizon commercial, you know, a McDonald's commercial, you know, this, that, or the other.
Imagine there's some sort of, like, bidding process that is kicking off right now, and then, you know, the ESPN people are perfectly content with the number, say, $20,000 a spot, like, that's what they're calling it at, and if you start bidding over it, then you get, like, you know, you're in the mix, and if people start, like, lining up, like, if you're getting, you know, a young person with money to spend that loves tech, then you're going to get a Microsoft Surface ad
or something. Yeah, it is, what was really interesting to me, I went to, I was telling him to this thing was about how much of these companies are going to start up. It's about like gathering data for people. Like so many people basically had businesses that a huge portion of it or a huge like plus for the business was that they were gathering data to help, you know, either companies market to more targeted end users or, you know, just for these, you know, they sell a service to help these people gather, you know, help teams gather data to market themselves. Like one guy had one that was like group sales for tickets. So instead of just getting one person's information, you get the entire group's information and you can find out more about your audience and who's there. And then you can like go and you have their email address and this and the other, probably so you can turn around and, you know, sell it to some spammer or something like that. And then, you know, it was amazing. There were a couple businesses that, like, a huge part of their business plan was essentially gathering data to then turn around and sell or, you know, to provide to another company.
So, yeah.
I guess not turn around and sell, but to help, you know, a baseball stadium or to help a golf course, like, collect data on who's playing at their course so that, you know, they can then have more sales leads. So, pretty crazy.
Crunching those numbers. One of my friends, he kind of does that in my understanding of what he does. He's a business intelligence engineer. And so it's just, yeah, he lives in that kind of big data world where it's just like crunching numbers and like running queries against like terabytes of data just to like figure out who has a bigger like chance of renewing their Amazon Prime student account, whatever.
Yeah. I think that's kind of what Chip does too, but I think he takes that data more and then turns it into like, how should we send these people like a brochure?
Yeah.
You know, how should we send them, you know, something? It's very, very interesting. I don't know. I guess I had previously never thought about how much of, you know, all that information that you enter and what that goes to and how people are making money off of that.
Yeah, it's a whole thing.
Yeah, man. It's the future of business and sales.
Google is mining our data stream right now, process, you know, how our living rooms are.
Yeah, exactly. And all of our excellent, you know,
Ideas
and discussions, probably. So there's probably one person out there watching this right now and be like, so how'd you end up making your millions? Well, I actually just found this random hangout and started in on it. I don't even think they realized it. Next thing I know, it's like how on UID they're always talking about how like they have ideas that they never follow through on that make other people rich or something like that.
Speaking of never following through on an idea, I feel like I was probably one of the first like 50 people to listen to their episode because I downloaded it like the second it came out. But they had an idea for graycoupon.com, and it's just like such a fucking funny idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's someone's just like sitting on it right now.
Yeah. Well, oh no, that was it. I was listening to the radio one day. And someone was talking about, like, basically did the same thing, and they were like, yeah, like, it'd be great if there was an app that did this, that, or the other. And I was like, that is a really good fucking idea. And they're like, well, we just gave, like, you know, a whole bunch of engineers, like, you know, web developers or engineers, you know, there's, like, they're probably already halfway through the app right now. Like, you know, like 30 seconds later, they're like, well, that's already being developed. Because it was some woman who was, you know, an app expert or something like that, and they were like, so what do you, like, really see as, like, an area that needs to be serviced? And they were like, well, I think, like, you know, services for, you know, like Uber for services is, like, a big area that you can, you know, like, Uber for dog walking or something. And they're like, oh, like, you know, somebody's already out there thinking, like, oh, Uber, like, for this or Uber for that, you know.
Yeah. Ideas are cheap, though. That's kind of the thing. It's just a matter of whether or not.
I've had so many, and I've just given them away.
Same here, man. I think I'm going to have my students use Stupid Chat App tomorrow for, like, an in-class chat room. Like,
nice.
So I figure, because they're not technical, so I feel like it's going to be too much to ask them to download, like, IRC and to set up, like, an IRC chat room and stuff. So just, like, hop in here to, like, stupidchatapp.com/whatever, and, like, get in. We'll have, like, a little room, and, like, you know, this is just for communicating between us. And, like... No one's going to see it or anything. Like, ask a question here, like, if you can't get my attention in time or whatever, and see if someone else in the classroom can, like, help you.
Cool. Yeah. And plus they can see what they can develop with their coding skills.
Yeah.
How many people are in the class tomorrow?
So as of 2 days ago, 7 people, which is less than I was expecting, but it's a good number for, like, my first try.
Pretty good, though, man. I mean, you got 7 people who are, is it paid or free, or?
Yeah, it's very paid.
Nice. But are you saying, like, hey, like, $50 a head to come out and do this, or is it, like, the local community place saying, hey, we'll pay you, you know, X, and you can come out and we'll put this class up and charge people?
It's through... Did you know that Adam did, like, a web development boot camp?
Yeah, but I didn't know... I thought he was doing it on his own, frankly.
Yeah, he paid, like, a lot of money to go do, like, a 3-month-long, like, immersive 40-hour-a-week kind of thing.
Yeah. It seemed like almost, like, condensed college or something for coding.
Yeah. And he ended up actually going back, and he's taught this same WordPress class, like, 2 or 3 times now. And he was telling me about it. So I was like, hey, I know WordPress. I've done, like, TA stuff before, like, this week. A walk in the park. It's a $250 ticket, and you get 50% of the take.
Wow.
So, yeah, he said that, like, his very first WordPress class, he thought there would be, like, 3 or 4 people in it, and there were, like, 22 heads in the class.
Damn.
And it's just, like, fuck. Like,
that's pretty awesome.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'll be happy, like, with what I walk out with, you know.
Yeah.
Hopefully I, like, kick ass and do well, and, like, everybody walks out feeling like they got a great deal. But, yeah, I mean, that's, like, a pretty good little bump. Like, I don't know what I'm going to do with that money, but... probably nickel and dime it.
Yeah, dude. No, it's pretty awesome. I mean, even just for, like, if you're not exceedingly busy on a weekend or something like that, to do that for, you know, a day or two
and make
some extra money, that's pretty sweet.
They just opened the office in Seattle, like, a month or two ago, so it's not kicking up. But I'm bummed there's a guy teaches this class. It's, like, basic HTML and CSS for 3 weeks, like, every Wednesday night, like, 6 to 9 or something. And it's, like, a $30 a head class, and he sells out, like, 45 seats every week.
Damn.
And I was just like, that is ridiculous. Like, I could teach that class blindfolded, like, with my hands tied behind my back.
Yeah, dude.
I was talking to the guy that organizes it, and I was like, so, like, is he going to do another one? Like, it's obviously selling out. Like, when are you going to offer a second one, and can I do that? And he was just like, well, it doesn't really work like that. Like, he's kind of got dibs on that class, like, if he wants it. And it's like, well, he needs to shit or get off the pot, because I would love to teach that class.
Yeah, man. That's, like, awesome. And do you have to do, like, any of the, like, marketing behind it, or does the company handle all of that?
The company handles all the marketing and stuff. And I think it's mostly, like, you kind of use the same lesson plan, like, every time you do it. So Adam gave me his materials, and, like, the guy gave me, they have kind of, like, company-wide, like, some resources. So that's kind of what I was supposed to be putting together tonight. I'll have to work on it after we hang up.
Yeah.
I've just kind of been slacking. I know, like, what I'm going to do, but I really kind of need to outline it and make sure that, like, the timeline fits up.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it'll be pretty good. I'm pretty excited. I kind of met, like, 2 people through email already, and we're kind of chatting just about, like, how the class is going to go, because they're... I sent out, like, an introductory email, kind of like, hey, come prepared with this, this, and this, and...
Yeah.
Yeah, two people already, like, jumped in with some questions, so...
So are these, like, completely blank slate people, or do they have any kind of background, or...?
Kind of sounds like it. Yeah, so it's, like, an absolute beginner class, so it's kind of like, you know, here's how you install WordPress and, like, get it up, you know, yeah. If that's what you want, but also you can just go to the website and use it, and, like, we're going to go through the admin panel, here's how you make a post, here's how you kind of, like, set up other users, like, blah, 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 you know, different plugins to use and things like that. Yeah, so it'll be pretty good. Get some people out there. Because, I mean, that's a really good... I think it's a pretty good deal. Some people, if they want... If you own, like, a mom-and-pop store or something, and you need to have a website up, like, people will sell you... They'll tell you that you need to spend $3,000 or $4,000 on having, like, your page up and things like that. And the reality of it is you can... spend like 10 hours of your time working on this thing, like 10 or 20 hours of your time, and have something up there that's going to do just as fine. Like if you're running a coffee shop or like a, you know, a coffee shop with a couple sandwiches, all you need to do is really get in there every month and update your menu and like keep your, you know, like keep your phone number up to date and things like that. And
yeah,
it might only contribute like a couple $100 a month, like to your bottom line, but that's a couple $100 a month. Paying for itself, like a lot better than like a huge upfront investment, like hiring a developer. That's kind of, yeah. I don't know. I think it's a good thing because there's like a ton of, man. I said there's this like really good coffee shop and like soup place down the street that we've been a couple of times, and they have different soups every day. But they don't have anything online or any sort of way of knowing what they get. So, like, on days I work from home, Lindsay calls me up and has me run down there. It's like a 10-minute drive. I have to take a fucking picture of their menu and send it to her and then wait for, like, 10 minutes while she kind of, like, I don't know, maybe you want this, maybe you want that. And then I order for her, and then it takes, like, another 10 minutes, and I, like, go deliver it. And I asked the one guy, I was like, hey, like, can you set up a Twitter or something? Like, this is, like, this is affecting me, like, pretty That's often. That's
exactly what Facebook is perfect for businesses.
Yeah, it's, like, so easy. And he was like, man, I just pour coffee, like, no, I hate computers. And then he, like, said something to another guy sitting there, and he was like, he's like, I hate computers. I don't understand how people can, like, make their living doing it. And he, like, went off in this whole thing that was kind of, like, negative towards me. And I was like, I mean, dude, like, I could be coming here, like, I don't know, fuck it.
No,
like,
no, that's just idiot move by that guy to not be like, I have a, that's insane.
There's like,
I mean, I understand that there's some people like that because... I've heard from people who worked for, like, CarMax and stuff like that as a salesperson trying to go into, like, you know, get, you know, some good old boy car dealership to, you know, sign up for cars.com or something like that. Of people just being like, well, we don't, you know, we've just always done it with a pad and paper. We don't trust the machines kind of thing.
Yeah.
Those people definitely exist across all things, but for, like, a local coffee shop to not want to, like, do that is kind of crazy because that sounds like a perfect format for something like Twitter or Facebook or something.
You don't have to be like Instagramming your latte art every day or like doing something like crazy like that. You're like just inform people, like just give them the shit they need to say like, hey, I'm just gonna go there because it's like I know what's on the fucking menu.
Well, exactly, man, and that's kind of where I feel like social media is great for like small businesses and people who constantly have stuff that's changing, like for, and especially selling directly to like your end, you know, your customer, your end user or whatever, because with like our company, we were like, oh my God, like social media is so important. And, you know, I disagree with that.
for our company, because we're selling business to business, I don't think most businesses are getting on being like, let's find, you know, promotional products and, you know, let's get on, you know, I think Facebook is the place to do that, but, you know, a place like a restaurant where it's, you know, you can immediately reach people who are genuinely interested in you very quickly with, you know, I mean, you can do it on your phone, you know, to be like, our soups today are tomato bisque, clam chowder, and corn chowder, like.
Yeah, like, here yeah, you go.
Like, ooh, I was thinking of going to, you know, Denny's, but I'll go get clam chowder now, like.
Yeah, now yeah. I know it's there, and, like, I know that it's not a 50-50 shot that I'll get fucking, like, cream of mushroom soup. Like,
yeah, or waste my time going down there by having, you know, someone wait for it.
Yeah, it, I don't know. It. I was listening. Yeah, it does. I was listening. It was another podcast actually, and this. It's kind of funny that this is all like coming together because this isn't what I had in mind when I brought this up. But they're talking about the difference between like content marketing and content strategy. Like content marketing. This lady was describing it as, like, writing a blog post. Like, it would be, like, if this coffee shop had a blog and they were, like, you know, top 10 coffee types of whatever and, like, shit like that. They were, like, no one really cares. It's just to, like, get their name out there more often and, like, kind of hoping that you get one or, like, a like or two on Facebook or whatever.
Yeah.
And, like, content strategy is, like, identifying, like, what actually matters. Like sure, you're not going to get a bunch of retweets on your soup menu, but, like, that really is the difference. Like no one cares if you do, like, top 10 soups of 2014.
Yeah.
Like, they want to know what's there right now, and they want, like, or, you know, you don't need to write a bunch of blog posts about, like, AWS, you know, for whatever reason, you need to, like, make sure your AWS, like, documentation's up to par, like, so people that are current customers, like, stay on it.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of like identifying that. It's like user experience plus, like, content, whatever. Yeah. It was pretty interesting. I didn't really even consider that until, like, I heard this lady talk. It made a lot of sense.
But, yeah.
I'm gonna get off that.
Like, we were talking about with, I think it was content, is, like, Noda, for example, does a whole bunch of, they do, like, hangouts with the brewer and this, that, and the other, and, like, I'm not going to, you know, spend an hour listening to the guy talk about, like, hops and yeast and this, that, and the other. Like, I just don't care, but I also, like, will go there to find out, like, what food truck they hire, any of the local, you know, places of, like, what food truck, you know, is going on there, like, what, like, special beer they have on draft or something like that.
Yeah.
Type of thing that I think is great for, you know, like you said, like, you know, the local soup shop doesn't need to be, like, you know, 10 best soups you've never heard of. They just need to do, like, you know, this is what we have today, and, like, this is why you should come by. It's, like, a good chance for them to sell.
Yeah, like, I don't know. People kind of forget, like, what the whole, what it's all about.
Yeah.
Just crazy.
I mean, social media with our company, I could rant forever about that because it's like, first of all, I don't think that it's like supposed to be, I don't think for our business and what we need to project is necessarily an important component at all, but we have this girl who they contract out to do it, and she does, I will say, an awful job. Like, it's, like, it's, she uses, like, all these, you know, she's apparently, like, her job is, like, a social media manager or something like that, which she doesn't work in the office, like, she's off-site, like, she basically just kind of freelances doing this stuff, and then it's, like, okay, like, send me some, you know.
Yeah.
PayPal me some money for this. So she's, I don't even know how we got hooked up with her, but she just, it seems like she breaks, like, all the rules for, like, business social media stuff because she just, like, puts up, like, just the dumbest stuff. It's just, like, it's, like, puppies and, like, kitten, like, you know, puppy kittens, like, TGIF kind of bullshit. Like, like, trolls Pinterest and then, throws up a whole bunch of hashtag vomit. I'm just, like, As an employee, I'm like, wow. Like, everyone needs to, like, you know, make sure that you guys like the page and stuff. I'm like, I don't even want to, like, admit that, like, I'm on the associated with this.
Yeah.
So bad. Like, yeah. And then the only other thing is it's my dad's business partner, you know, trying to, like, fulfill herself with being, whatever, it's a whole other story, but trying to be like, oh, look at how charitable and great I am. And it's like, none of this helps actually, like, do anything for our business other than, like, expose, like, a bunch of dumb pictures that, you know, people took, or, like, some dumb shit that we did at the office that basically makes it look like we're, like, slacking off all that.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, ugh, social media. But, yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those things, like,
I mean, it definitely is, it's important, man, but I think for our business, trying to sell business to business, Facebook isn't designed for business to business interaction necessarily, or, you know, marketing to another business. I think that's maybe more Twitter. I could be totally wrong on that. I don't really know too much about Twitter. I don't really get on there.
I do it in bursts. So.
Yeah, I'll go through bursts of, like, checking it, but I think all of the tweets that I've ever put up are retweets. Like, and it was like, you know, Meta World Peace or something saying, like, I love grapes, and then another. Like, we're all not that funny or something. Like, it's just, like, absolute dumb stuff. Like,
you know, yeah.
But
deep Twitter or whatever.
Huh?
Deep Twitter or dark Twitter, whatever the...
Black Twitter.
Well, black Twitter's different.
Oh, okay.
not that type of dark. There's, like, yeah, black Twitter's fucking hilarious. I don't really know, I don't even know where to get it on my Twitter thing, but on, like, Imgur or whatever, they'll have, like, a big summary. It'll be, like, 100, like, black Twitter posts, and it's just fucking hilarious.
I've never seen that. It's pretty funny.
But, was it Twitter or whatever? It's, like, some Pat Wheeler shit. Like... Yeah, I kind of like Lindsay's company. Like, she does a little bit of social media and stuff. It's a little bit, that's kind of part of her job description. But, like, they do green renovations, and they have, like, an actual product. Like, their social media stuff is, it's all, like, oh, hey, sweet-ass, like, kitchen we just redid, and it's, like, Pinterest quality, like, whatever. Yeah. And, like, that's cool. I think, like, I draw the line on, like, social media for social media's sake. Like, when it's, like, you're not saying anything. Like, you're just trying to get out there versus, like, here's something we provide to you.
Like, yeah, exactly.
A little bit of, like, a value proposition. I don't know.
Yeah, that's where I think our...
You're muted right now. I don't know how it happened. Can't hear shit. Yell loud enough to wake Candace up.
Yeah, she'll be thrilled.
Right. I can hear you now.
Okay. Yeah, I know what happened.
We were ranting about social media, and then social media cut us off.
Goddamn social media. Yeah, well, this is what happens if you open the social media vortex.
Yeah. We're still feeling the aftershocks from that shit.
Still feeling that, and it's tying back. I feel like we have the foundations of a good podcast here, so let's put that down as another thing on the table.
we're obviously doing it, like.
Yeah, this is the early stages.
Yeah, we've got a big chunk of marble, and we just gotta chisel it down.
Like, do something with it here. Story of my life. But,
Yeah, body by push.
Yeah, exactly. Have you by hand chance made the coconut mojitos yet? Did you tell Lindsay the secret recipe prior to her bartending debut?
No, she knows about it. I used that almost immediately to get out of the doghouse with her. I kind of told you how I was in the shit, like, as we were in Puerto Rico. I used that as kind of like a, hey, babe, still thinking about you kind of situation. But no, we haven't been. I'm not really drinking a lot of liquor these days, so it's kind of hard.
Yeah.
But.
Not a big liquor drinker in general, so that's what got me in Puerto Rico. It wasn't, you know, my dark, dark inner demons. It was demon alcohol.
Yeah. I'm glad I stayed relatively clean on that front.
Well, that's good.
Nothing too crazy.
Yeah. That's very important. I finally unpacked the coffee from that trip. It was sitting on my desk in the bag I bought it in the store at for God knows how long, but 3 weeks, but
I just had some this morning, actually. We just got into it ourselves. It's not too bad.
Yeah, man. Well, very, very tasty.
Yeah, I haven't been using my Puerto Rico mug. I need to bust that out.
Mine broke in the ultimate, like, nut kick of travel back from that trip. The handle broke.
Oh my
god. Like the bottom half. I need to try to glue it. I've kept it wrapped because I'm going to wait until I get up to Lake, but the damn thing broke. I got home and I was like, well, at least I still have this dope mug. And then, like, half of the sea handle mug fell off. I was like, god damn it. This had to have happened because I was in transit for, like, 36 hours. I was like, I guess what happens, I have to use my bag as a pillow going to sleep, so.
That's what it was, your big-ass head.
Yeah, this massive brain that I have. Actually, it's just all water. It's like the Homer Simpson brain. It kind of sloshes around.
Yeah.
That's where the fluid ideas come from.
Yeah. Secure the ocean.
Yeah. Exactly. All right, man, well, I'm going to jump, but I'll let you start writing up your lesson plan.
Yeah, I got to do what I got to do.
Yeah, dude. You better hope Lindsay's not doing Coyote Ugly stuff tonight or something like that, like dancing on the bar.
I was asking her, I was like, so have you been tasting the drinks to make sure they're still all right? Like, because I didn't see a lot of that back in Charlotte. I don't know if it's like a law thing or whatever, but like here the bartenders will like take a shot. And stuff like that, like a lot more freely than I would saw in North Carolina ever.
I think in North Carolina it's illegal to drink on the job. I'm actually most positive because Chip Lumpert got fired from Longshanks for that. So this was like when Longshanks was like super like grimy. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, they were basically just like, don't, you know, whatever. I mean, not that it's a nice bar now, but you know, I can only imagine. The Bible Belt has a little different rules than a place where, you know, you can walk into a store and buy weed, so it's,
Well, Longshanks was grimy at the point where they were willing to hire Chip.
Yeah, so. Exactly. When they were willing to hire, like, super drunk young Chip, and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
not respectful, big data Chip.
Yeah, no. Well, yeah, it's amazing how quickly, like, getting a job and having a girlfriend, like, housebroken is actually quite disturbing. Because he was immediately just like...
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, he immediately was just like, oh, like, now, you know, I love, like, you know, hanging out with these two tiny dogs that my girlfriend had, and, you know, like...
I wear ties now.
Yeah, also, I'm gluten-free now. Like, he changed his shit real quick. He's always
been a game of Crohn's with Chip.
Yeah. No, I mean, if anybody needs to be on a health-based diet, it's probably Chip, but I don't know, like, gluten-free, some bad diets necessarily the way to do it, so...
I saw... There was an Onion article. It was like, local man still considered a train wreck after cleaning up his act like 5 years ago or whatever. It was just how, like, about Chip and how everyone still thinks he's a shithead, even though, like, 5 years ago he, like, got a job and, like, got married and, like, did whatever, but, like, he just used to be a shit show and he's still a shit. It's fine.
Dude, he's so funny now. He, like, bought a house. He, like, went from, like, 0 to 60. Like, he all of a sudden just, like, got a girlfriend. I was like, well, I'm going to be a big boy now, and, like, got a house and a girlfriend, and was like, this is what I'm doing. So he,
good for him.
Yeah, he gets into it. He's remodeling a house now. He bought a house, and I don't want to say it sounds like he's, you know, trying to make it, like, open concept of his, you know, old ranch home or something like that, but it sounds a lot like that.
Yeah.
With the IKEA kitchen dropping and redoing all the hardwood floors. Where he gets the money, I don't ask, but that's up to him.
Yeah. Good for him.
Yeah.
I want to get back to Charlotte and get a house before shit gets too expensive, man.
You're too late. We're too late.
Well, I'm not, though, because I live in, like, one of... I mean, it's up there right now. It's so expensive here.
Yeah.
Like, one of my coworkers just bought a house for, like, $550,000 or $600,000. And that was, like, a steal.
That's insane, dude.
Yeah, it's, like, it's stupid. There's no reason I would ever... The house that we live in right now is... it's... I just saw the taxation thing. It's, like... $369,000, like, the government assessed value, and $69,000 from the house. Like, it's all the property.
Wow.
It's just, like, we live on top of, like, a big, pretty hill in Seattle, and that's it. Like,
yeah.
Like an 800 square foot house.
That's crazy, man. Yeah, we've started kind of ramping up our search here, and it's just. I was telling my dad today when I was home, went up to Greensboro for the day, about basically the house that we had in Greensboro. If we could pick that house up on that lot and drive it to, like, where we want to be in Charlotte, it would easily be double the cost, like, of what we paid for it. And he was just like, you realize, like, the value of the house that you have, which is, like, half the size of my parents' house in Greensboro, probably way less than half the size. Maybe, like, we'll say half the size for argument's sake because I'm terrible at estimating square footage. He was like, you realize the value of our house is, like, basically the value of that. Like, it was like, that's insane for what. Like, I almost think that you're in, I almost feel like we're at a point where it would almost be better to kind of, like, ride it out another year or two and see if it drops a little bit.
Yeah. Because
I almost feel like it's so crazy, like, the amount of apartments and this, that, and the other that they're building around here, and just, like, how, like, quickly all these prices, the prices and everything from what I've heard have gone up, that it almost seems like a bubble. And, like, if we could maybe wait, but at the same time, like, all these houses are going on the market, and it, like, sells, you know, like, for where we're looking in, like, Midwood and stuff like that. Like, everything sells in, like, a day, or, you know, has an offer within a day, and it's just, insane. So, we'll see.
Yep, seen a lot of that. I've been keeping an eye on it back in Charlotte, and then I've been kind of keeping an eye. It's hard not to see it here, but
yeah,
I'm bummed. My friend Nick, his house is probably a little bit further away from the city than where you'd want to be, but he just got an offer in on it. It's like a beautiful house, but I think I mentioned it to you, and I definitely mentioned it to him because he was looking for someone to buy it. And we were just joking. I was like, "Hey, man, I will hook this up for 3%. Like, I'll make it happen for you. Like, I will get you two talking, and we will sell a damn house."
Dude, honestly, if you know anyone, let us know, because we, like, even when we were over at Clayton Ashley's the other day, like, one of their neighbors was like, oh, the people across the street are considering, like, selling their house in, like, a couple months. And we were like, seriously, like, do you guys, like, know them? Like, because
if we're
willing to, like, put it on the market and they want to save themselves, like, 6%, like, we're, like, neighborhood's, like,
I don't know how this works, but, like.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's kind of out of our price range. We were like, honestly, like, if, you know, what are they thinking of putting it? Like, if you next time, if you guys see them, like, maybe casually ask them, like, what are you thinking, and like, when, like, we would really like like to do that, like, you know, at least like hear what they're saying on that. So it's nuts, man, because it really is. Like, even the realtor guy that we met, he was like, yeah, like, he has a pretty big like focus in Midwood or whatever, so we're like, that's part of the reason that we went with him, to because he's like, oh, I like represent a lot of people in the area, so he's like, I can hopefully find out about stuff before it comes on the market, you know, over other realtors. So I don't know, we'll end up seeing what happens, but of course, like, the week we really try to ramp it up, like, nothing went on the market, so it's been real.
Yeah, you'll get there.
We'll see. Yeah, we got time before we have to renew our lease or something like that. So,
mm-hmm. Word. Cool. Yeah. Well, this has been the inaugural episode.
Yeah, I know. Oh. This is Hang Chat.
This is Hang Chat.
288.
Or Hangstream.
Voicemail.
Yeah.
I'll play some outro music.
888-842-2357.
Yeah, 888. Deep belts.
Yeah.
Can you hear the music that I'm playing?
I can. Only a little bit. Now I can hear it.
This is the outro music. It doesn't really fit. I don't have the musical taste that Jonathan does. I don't have the Jonathan musical taste. Raytram, or whatever they say.
It's perfect. You just have to own it and stop laughing through it.
Exactly. Just fade out. We should have ended the banter at the intro.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we have room to improve on future episodes.
Hey, you gotta set a bar and then you gotta beat the bar.
Exactly.
All right. Seatbelts.